أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله تعالى فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Indeed, all praises due to Allah Jalla wa Ala. We praise Him and we seek His help and His forgiveness. And we seek refuge from the evils of our own selves and from the evils of our own deeds. Whomsoever Allah Jalla wa Ala guides, no one can lead astray. And whomsoever Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala allows to go astray, no one can guide. And I bear witness that there is no true God worthy of worship except Allah, alone without any partners. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his servant and his last and final messenger to mankind. أما بعد فإن خير الحديث كلام الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. The best speech, brothers and sisters, is the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The best guidance is that which was brought to us by Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. The worst of affairs are the ones that are invented into the religion, and every invention is an act of misguidance. And every act of misguidance can potentially take us to the fire. May Allah protect us all. Allah Azza wa Jalla mentions in the Quran, Ya ayyuhan nas, uttaqu rabbakum alladhi khalaqakum min nafsin wahida, wa khalaqa minha zawjaha, wa batha minhuma rijalan kathiran wa nisa'a. Wattaqu Allah alladhi tasa'aluna bihi wal arham, inna Allah kana alaykum raqiba. This verse, which translates as, O mankind, be conscious of Allah and fear your Lord, who has created you from a single soul, and from this soul He has created its spouse, Adam and Hawa, Adam and Eve. And from both of them He has created many men and women, all of mankind. And be conscious of Allah, through whom you demand your mutual rights, and never cut the ties of kinship. Yet in another verse, Allah Jalla wa Ala tells us, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu ittaqullaha haqqa tuqati وَلَا تَمُوتُنَّ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ. O you believe, be conscious of Allah Jalla wa Ala as befits His Majesty, and never die except as Muslims. Never die except as those who submit to Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. Brothers and sisters, Alhamdulillah, I feel honored to be invited to be your khatib for today. And inshallah ta'ala, we pray that Allah benefits us and puts this all on our scale of good deeds. Ameen. There are few things in this world that we are sure about. We are uncertain about many things. But among them, the few things that we are sure and we have certainty and yaqeen in is that we all have to taste death. We all must leave this world. From the minute a child is born, or from the minute we hear that this child now has a heartbeat, this child is alive, the fetus is alive, we know that death has been written for this living creature. As Allah Jalla wa Ala tells us, كُلُّ نَفْسٍ ذَائِقَةُ الْمَوْتِ. Every soul will taste death. We may not know when it's going to happen, where it will take place, how it will reach us. As Allah tells us, وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ بِأَيِّ أَرْضٍ تَمُوتِ. And no soul knows where death is going to take them, when the angel of death is going to come to us. However, brothers and sisters, we are certain that it will take us. Human beings across the board, they know that. And many accept it and many try to fight it. But as Muslims, we are told, كُلُّ نَفْسٍ ذَائِقَةُ الْمَوْتِ. You cannot repel death when it comes. You embrace it and you prepare for it. Brothers and sisters, death discriminates no one. When the angel of death comes, it doesn't matter how old, how young, rich or poor. The old and the young, everyone tastes death. Those middle-aged people, they taste death as well. Even the fetus, as we mentioned, before the fetus is born, the soul is going to taste death. Brothers and sisters, what we must ask ourselves is what happens after death? What takes place after the angel of death comes, after that person dies? If you ask different people, you get different answers. But as Muslims, people that believe in the Quran as the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to be also revelation from Allah jalla wa ala, we have a clear picture, crystal clear, what will take place after death. Brothers and sisters, as Muslims, we must believe in three main stages. Three main stages after death. Three main stages. The first stage is al-barzakh. The barzakh, the life of the grave. The second stage is al-ba'th wa nushur wal-hisab, is the stage of resurrection where Allahu Azwajal will unite the soul with the body, put the body back together. And he will unite the soul with the body. And part of that stage is that they will be tested and they will be brought to account for their deeds. Al-ba'th wa nushur. And the third stage and the last stage is al-jaza, the reward or the recompensation that comes. And we know there are only two places. There is al-jannah, may Allah make us to be among the people of Jannah. And there's an-nar, the hellfire. Wal-iyadu billah, may Allah protect us from it. But those are the three stages. There's the barzakh, the life of the barzakh. This ends when the trumpet is blown and we are put back together and we are brought to account for our deeds. And then depending on the results, there's either Jannah or Jahannam. Every Muslim must believe in this. Believe meaning not based on my grandparents told me this or my mother told me this, based on evidence from the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is not a matter of tales being carried on after generation. This is a matter of evidence, revelation, and we must have certainty in everything that comes after death. We are not allowed to have any doubt as Muslims in what comes after death. The barzakh, Allah Azza wa Jal tells us about the barzakh in the Quran and in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah Jalla wa Ala tells us, hatta idha jaa ahadahum al-maut qala rabbi irji'un. And when the time of death comes, one of them, Allah is describing to these believers specifically, they will say, my Lord, send me back. Send me back to this dunya. رَبِّ ارْجِعُونَ لَعَلِّي أَعْمَلُ صَالِحًا فِي مَا تَرَكْتُ, so that I can do good deeds, the things that I didn't do in this world. Allah says, كَلَّا, absolutely not. إِنَّهَا كَلِمَةٌ هُوَ قَائِلُهَا, these are just words that he is saying, lip service. Because Allah knows that that person, even if he was a send back, he wouldn't do a thing differently. Allah is fair. إِنَّهَا كَلِمَةٌ هُوَ قَائِلُهَا وَمِنْ وَرَائِهِمْ بَرْزَخْ. And after that, meaning after that death, the angel of death comes, after that there is al-barzakh, the barzakh which is the life of the grave. وَمِنْ وَرَائِهِمْ بَرْزَخٌ إِلَى يَوْمِ يُبْعَثُونَ. And the barzakh continues until the day they are resurrected. Allah tells us about Fir'aun, the evil Fir'aun, Pharaoh, and his people. Allah says, "An-naru yu'raduna 'alayha ghuduwan wa 'ashiyya, wa yawma taqumu sa'a adkhilu 'ala fir'auna ashadd al-'adhab." He tells us that Fir'aun, we know what Fir'aun did. He was a big tyrant. Allah says that the people of Fir'aun and his people are being exposed to the fire night and day. Ghuduwan wa 'ashiyya, right now as we speak. Wa yawma taqumu sa'a. And the day when the hour is established, meaning on the day of judgment, when everyone is put back together, it will be said to them, أَدْخِلُوا آلَ فِرْعَوْنَ أَشَدَّ الْعَذَابِ. Enter the people of Fir'aun in a more severe punishment, which is the fire of the Nar, or the hellfire. This is two verses from the Quran. The hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, as collected by Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma. He said, مَرَّ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ عَلَى قَبْرَيْنِ جَدِيدَيْنِ. The Prophet صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ passed by two graves, new graves. People were just buried in that grave. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Innahuma la yu'adhaban wa ma yu'adhabani fi kabirin." These two people that were just put in this grave, they are being punished right now. But they're not being punished for something that we take to be serious. It's something that we consider to be light. Human beings consider to be a light thing. What are those two things? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Amma ahaduhuma," as for one of them, فَكَانَ لَا يَسْتَتِرُ مِنَ الْبَوْلِ كَانَ لَا يَسْتَتِرُ مِنَ الْبَوْلِ. As for one of them, he used to go and urinate and he would not protect himself from getting urine on his clothing. As Muslims, we have to perform the salah. But the salah is not accepted unless we have purification. And we are impure if we have urine on our clothing. This is one of the reasons why men are recommended to sit and urinate whenever the conditions are okay. Why? Because it prevents any type of splashes on his skin or on his clothing. So one of them was being punished because he wouldn't protect himself from the urine, meaning his salah would be accepted because of that. وَأَمَّا الْآخَرَ, and as for the other person, فَكَانَ يَمْشِي بِالنَّمِيمَةِ, he used to walk around and spread malicious lies and gossip. Namima is where you walk around and you put this person against the next one. You go around and you say, "You know so-and-so, that person that you know, he said this about you." And you go to the same person, he said, "You know, this one said that about you," to make them fight and become enemies. Two sins. A lot of times people gossip and we don't realize that this sin is very grave. It's not just words, it has consequences. So these two people were being punished. The Prophet ﷺ said, they're being punished right now in the life of Al-Barzakh. But the Barzakh is also a place for bliss. For those who do good deeds, inshallah, the life of the Barzakh is better than this life. When somebody dies, we make dua for them. Part of that dua is we say, "Oh Allah, give them a spacious grave. Give them good companions. Make this grave better than what they have in this world." So the life of the Barzakh is better than this dunya that we have right now, if we live a righteous life and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives us for our shortcomings. So the Barzakh is very important. Then we have Al-Ba'th wa Nushur. We have putting back everyone being resurrected and everyone accounting for their deeds. This is mentioned all over in the Quran. We recite it in the day 17 times. Maliki yawmiddin. Allah is Maliki yawmiddin. He is the Malik, the owner and the king of what? The day of resurrection. So we must believe in this as Muslims. And then the last stage that we must believe in as Muslims is Al-Jannatu wa Nar, Jannah wa Jahannam. That there's heaven and there's hell. Heaven and hell, they are created right now as we speak, they exist. We may not know where it is and it doesn't matter where it is. Allah says that it exists right now. And it's waiting for its occupants. May Allah protect us. May Allah make us to be among the people of Jannah. May Allah save us so that we're not among the people of the hellfire, us and our families all. Brothers and sisters, the important question is, what are we preparing? What are we preparing for the hour? If we know it exists, if we know what comes after death, are we preparing? Are we preparing anything? And if we are we preparing something that is good? To answer the first question, are we preparing anything? Yes. Every human being is preparing for their death. Whether they believe in it or they don't believe in it. Their deeds that they're living by now, whether they're Muslim or non-Muslim, atheist, agnostic, they are preparing right now for the death, the fact that they are alive, because Allah is going to question everyone about their deeds. So we just have to make sure that our preparations are good. We are doing the good deeds that will enter us into Jannah, inshallah. And we're staying away from the bad deeds that will cause us to be in the hellfire. And we have to make that preparation. Brothers and sisters, we pray and we ask Allah Jalla wa Ala to help us to be among those Muslims who prepare and make every effort for the hereafter. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-Azim wa nafa'ani wa iyaakum bima fihi min al-ayati wa dhikri al-hakim. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfiru Allah li wa lakum wa lisa'il muslimina min kulli dhanb fastaghfiruhu innahu huwa al-ghafurur rahim. الحمد لله على إحسانه وشكر له على توفيقه وامتنانه، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم. How do we prepare for the hereafter? How do we prepare for that journey that we know we're going to take? Some people look at it as a test. So we have to prepare for that test. Just like you wouldn't go and enter a test and say, oh, I'm going to wing it. You can't wing this exam. You have to prepare for it. If you consider it a trip, a journey, you have to prepare yourself. Allah says, وَتَزَوَّدُوا, take provisions with you. فَإِنَّ خَيْرَ الزَّادِ تَقْوَى. And the best provisions that one can take is the good deeds. At-taqwa, having piety and fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Brothers and sisters, to prepare for this journey that we'll all take, we need to have iman first and foremost. Believe in it with yaqeen, certainty. We cannot be believers if we have the smallest amount of doubt in the hereafter. That is so important. So if a man or a woman, they're working, making all this effort, but yet they believe in their hearts, maybe, you know, رُبَّمَا يَطَّلَي وَمَا فِي شَيْءٍ. They believe that, you know, we might die, and guess what? Maybe there's nothing after death. So he's doing good deeds just in case. In case there's something after death, he's got something to present. That's not acceptable. That person doesn't believe in al-yawm al-akhir, the last day, because he has doubt. And doubt is not acceptable, especially when it comes to our faith and our iman and the kalima la ilaha illallah. We must believe 100%. Sometimes you might be lazy and you might make a few mistakes here and there, but the minute we start having doubt in this kalima la ilaha illallah and everything that's entailed, we have doubt, then subhanallah, may Allah have mercy upon us. But as Muslims, we must prepare and we must have strong iman, strong faith in what is to come. Now, brothers and sisters, Allah tells us in the Quran, Surah Al-Baqarah, tells us about those believers, the successful ones, الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ. They are those who believe in the unseen. We live in a generation where they believe in whatever they can see. We have to make sure that our children and all of us, we increase our iman by seeking knowledge of the deen from the Quran and the Sunnah. You cannot brainwash someone and tell a child a million times, you must believe in the last day. He has to believe with his own heart. He has to see the evidence in front of him. He has to see the Quranic verses. He has to see the hadith. He has to contemplate life. In the beginning, yes, he may have some doubt, but that doubt must be overshadowed by evidence from the Quran and the Sunnah. And we have to strive with our money, our wealth, and everything we have to make sure our kids are believers. And make dua to Allah. We're living in a bad time. In the United States, all over, whether it's New York City, whether it's Florida, I've seen people who memorize the Quran. When they go to college, they come to me and they may say, is it possible that we evolved from monkeys? Is it possible that Allah didn't create us? Major doubts that takes them out of Islam. But yet this child spent hours upon hours, hundreds of hours, memorizing the Quran. Yet they have doubt that Allah created us. So we have to know where we're investing our time and money. This is a big loss. So brothers and sisters, we have to prepare ourselves with strong knowledge. Iman doesn't come about by blindly following something. You have to be convinced in your heart. And you can only do that by seeking knowledge from the Quran and the Sunnah. Brothers and sisters, after that we must then work hard. Work hard, not just have iman, but work hard for the hereafter. Work hard for our place in Jannah. Work hard for that. The companions, radhiyallahu anhum, that's what they did. It was mentioned to one companion. One companion was mentioned to him that he was seen in a dream crawling into Jannah. Crawling into Jannah. Going into Jannah, right? You'll say, Alhamdulillah, he's going into Jannah. The Sahabi, radhiyallahu anhum, he didn't accept that. He donated whatever he had. He said, I don't want to crawl into Jannah. I want to be walking or running into Jannah. Donated whatever he had. Meaning he spent. And he did as many good deeds as he could possibly do to go into Jannah. We have to have that type of idea and that attitude towards the hereafter. Brothers and sisters, if you think about it, it's like a suitcase that we're filling. We're filling our suitcase because we're going to make a trip one day. We're going to make a very important trip. And it's going to come without a doubt. That trip, you can't put your money in there. Your money's not going to go. You can't take your family members with you. They're not going to go into that suitcase with you. As much as you love them and they love you, they're not going to go with you on that trip. You're going by yourself. The only thing you can take in that grip, in that suitcase, in that shanta, is your deeds. A'malukum. The Prophet ﷺ, he said, يَتْبَأُ الْمَيِّتِ ثَلَاثَ. Three things follow the deceased to the grave. The Prophet ﷺ mentioned, أَهْلُهُ وَمَالُهُ وَعَمَلُهُ. His family will follow him to the grave, to the cemetery, not into the grave. To the cemetery, his family will go. His wealth will go. You will see his cars and so on that he bought. Someone else is driving it now. Driving to the cemetery, saying their goodbyes. And his deeds also are going to go to the cemetery. فَيَرْجِعُ إِثْنَانْ وَيَبْقَى وَاحِدْ. Two things are going to return and go back home to the house. And one is going to stay with that individual, with the deceased. One thing will stay. What are the two things that will go back? His wealth is going to go back. He's not going to enter the grave with him. His family are going to go back. As much as your family love you, or you love them, they're not going to go into the grave with you. You're on your own. The only thing is your deeds. The only thing you can take with you is your deeds. I say this today because I see it. I see it in our community, I see it in other communities. People are becoming attached so much to their family and their wealth, they don't want to leave it. And they don't realize that they're not going to be able to take it. It can't go into that suitcase. It's not going to go. So we have to focus on what we will actually take in the hereafter, which is our good deeds. So brothers and sisters, we pray that Allah Jalla wa'ala gives us firm iman, firm faith in the last day. Brothers and sisters, a little story I would like to share with you. And it makes complete sense when you look at this analogy. Many people don't prepare and they say that they believe in Islam, but they don't make any preparations. In Florida, we face a lot of hurricanes. Hurricanes. Okay? The last one that I was part of, and I say Alhamdulillah because I learned a lot from it. Hurricane Irma. Irma took about 80 lives from where it hit landfall. About 80 lives it took. When this hurricane came, many people, when you speak to them, they have different views about the hurricane. Some people say it's a big scam. The government is just, it's a scam, there's no hurricane. They just say that so you can go buy plywood and so on at Home Depot. That there's a big, you know, arrangement, so they make up all these lies so that people will spend money to prepare for the hurricane. So some people don't prepare because of it. You ask others, they say, oh, what do they know? Come on, you know. Even Muslims, they will say, Tawakkul ala Allah, brother, put your trust in Allah. What are you going to prepare for? If you got to die, you got to die. Which is wrong Islamically. You're supposed to prepare. You're supposed to protect yourself, save your life if it's coming. Some people are told to evacuate certain regions. They don't evacuate. They say, oh, I went through these hurricanes already. I can handle this. No big deal. So they don't board up their houses. They don't evacuate. They don't put sandbags. They don't do anything. A lot of those people, they die. They die in hurricanes. When it's time for help and they make the call, 911 says, I'm not going to come out. Because we told you to evacuate. It's not safe for the emergency workers to go in to save you. So they stay there and they die. If they believed, if they had belief that this hurricane was real, they would have prepared. They did not believe in it, so they did not prepare for it. As Muslims, if we do not prepare for the hereafter, it means we do not believe in the hereafter. And if we say we believe 100%, we have to prepare. I know life is busy. You're in the big city. Life and work and opportunities. But don't forget, your purpose in life is not the dunya. Your purpose in life is to prepare for the hereafter, which is going to come to us. Doesn't matter where you live. So brothers and sisters, we pray that Allah Jalla wa'ala blesses us all to believe and have yaqeen in the hereafter. and to help us to prepare for this trip that we're all gonna take. We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to give us knowledge and teach us that which will benefit us. We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to put iman in our hearts. Help us to make the effort to attend the masajid, attend the classes, attend the durus, to participate in community activities, to do everything that will benefit us and benefit our families in the last day. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal to forgive us for any of our shortcomings. And lastly, brothers and sisters, I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rewards everyone and blesses this jama'ah and this community for the effort that they're making. May Allah bless your community. May Allah bless everyone, the administrators who help function, make this community function. May Allah give you all tawfiq and iman to keep doing what you're doing, and even do more that you may need to do later on in the future. Because as Muslims, you always have to start thinking. What works for us today may change in 20 years from now. And we may have to adjust the way we see things. But we have to keep striving to provide the services for the Muslims. We pray and we ask Allah Azza wa Jal to help us and to forgive us for any of our shortcomings. Allahumma arina al-haqqa haqqan warzuqna tiba'a. Wa arina al-batila batilan warzuqna jitinaba. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار ثم اعلموا رحمكم الله أن الله أمركم بالصلاة والسلام على خير الأنام فقال تعالى إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على عبدك ورسولك نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وارض اللهم عن الخلفاء الراشدين الأئمة المهديين أبي بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي وعن سائر تابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين عباد الله اذكروا الله العظيم الجليل يذكركم واشكروه على نعمه يزدكم ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون وأقم الصلاة.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر.